A warning, this episode contains crude language and threats of violence.
Don't use big words to educate us. Don't repeat the words that you have read. If we F your ass, you will get pregnant.
Those words weren't easy for pro-democracy Burmese activist Ninthet Mukhain to read out loud. Over video call, I noticed that her confident demeanour is replaced by a subtle slump. And after her eyes trail back from the message on her phone to the computer screen, she awkwardly smiles. Confronting abuse online isn't easy.
So you've now read that and I can see the shock on your face. How does that make you feel?
I mean, scared, a little bit scared, because I can see the intensity of the hatred that contained when they wrote it. But also I feel sad because that was not my intention, right? I didn't attack them, but they attacked me.
The message, a response to a Facebook post she wrote in which she condemned the use of a racist slur against Muslims in Myanmar, she says is tantamount to the N-word. This abusive reply is only the tip of the iceberg.
It's like hundreds and hundreds, maybe even thousands, so I can't even count them. Sometimes they message me on Messenger and send things like, oh, we're gonna rape your mother, we're gonna rape you.
Hanin uses social media for her activism, hosting panel discussions on Facebook and Clubhouse, and to speak out against the military government, which came into power after a coup just over 2 years ago. She says the abuse really ramped up after the takeover. As a result, she was forced to flee the country.
Some of those are really nasty that I feel scared in my real life. Like if someone looked at me in the street or, you know, when I'm talking or things like that, then I would always feel like, oh, is he looking at me because he's the one who threatened me?
I'm Reha Kansara, and this is BBC Trending's new series, Trolled. We're delving deep into how online abuse is affecting people around the world and the forces at work on the dark side of social media. Now, in this episode, research shared with our team shows that Burmese women who speak up against the regime are being systematically targeted with hate speech and abuse. The NGO Myanmar Witness documented online attacks against women, the vast majority of which were posted on Telegram and Facebook. But who is behind this abuse, and what do they seek to gain? Women have been at the forefront of the narrative ever since the coup in 2021, when a female fitness instructor's livestream exercise routine captured the moment Myanmar lurched back into military rule after a decade of democracy. You may have seen it. She's doing a routine in a square near Myanmar's parliament, when suddenly, in the background, police and military vehicles speed towards government buildings. This moment set off a chain reaction. And since that day, civil war rages in the country. And the resistance, also known as the pro-democracy movement, continues to protest in Myanmar's biggest cities. These pro-democracy protests have been largely organised online. Hanin participated in some of them before she left Myanmar. But she and other female activists I speak to tell me the military government operates to quash any form of resistance. People who oppose the government live in fear, offline and online. Over a sketchy internet connection from a secret location in the Burmese jungle, Aethin Zamao tells me she's on the army's most wanted list. She uses social media to campaign and communicate with her audience.
Day by day, the army-owned media and military lobbyists direct message me. I want to sleep with you. I will destroy you. I will kill you.
At just 28 years old, the activist-turned-opposition minister's profile has grown, making her an even easier target. She told me she receives at least 500 abusive messages daily. Now, you might think this number is an exaggeration. But she has a massive online presence through her own accounts and official opposition accounts. A lot of the messages she receives are generically critical.
They say, we are in politics after taking foreign money. We are dollar eaters. We are under the influence of the West. We are also destroying our race and religion.
But others go further and attack her.
And then there are a lot of insults based on me being a woman, my ethnicity and my existence. Some of them are not even very appropriate to talk about here, but I get Muslim's wife, whore, and slut.
Let's be clear. Being a Muslim's wife isn't a bad thing. It's racism combined with misogyny. The majority Buddhist country's recent history is wrapped up in ethno-nationalism, and it's led to widespread hate of the minority Muslim Rohingya population, which back in 2017 led to an estimated 10,000 Rohingya Muslims being killed. In 2018, Facebook admitted its platform was used to incite offline violence during this time. Then, in 2021, the US government recognized it as genocide.
The United States has concluded that genocide was committed 7 times. Today marks the 8th, as I have determined that members of the Burmese military committed genocide and crimes against humanity against Rohingya. The attack against Rohingya was widespread and systematic, which is crucial for reaching a determination of crimes against humanity.
Wei Pyo Mint is the Myanmar lead for the digital rights nonprofit Access Now. She calls what is happening there a direct consequence of Myanmar's digital coup.
The military, they block, you know, like a social media to restrict, you know, people access to these online media, people access to this information available online. And also they try to stop, you know, people like using these social media platforms and that to mobilize the movement against the coup, you know. So that's what we have seen in the early days of the coup.
This crackdown online by the military is having some impact, but not enough to destabilize the resistance, who use social media to organize and strategize.
Military also use these digital tools to be able to oppress people. But at the same time, you know, people on the ground are also using these social media platforms to be able to fight against this military and also stay keeping this revolution alive. They are finding ways, you know, to make it like this revolution get stronger as well.
So who are the people behind these attacks? Athinzar claims most of the hate she receives comes from army-owned media and lobbyists. We can't say for certain it does. However, we can say that a majority of the abuse Burmese women face is coming from pro-military actors active on Telegram and Facebook. That's according to a recent report by Myanmar Witness. Mimi Kant, a researcher who worked on it, reveals their findings.
The main finding is that women in Myanmar are being targeted for their political activities, opinions, and beliefs at a very significant volume. And we see that on both sides of the political spectrum, and we see that from both pro-military and pro-democracy side. But almost 90% of these abuses have been authored by pro-military channels and accounts. And out of them, over 80% of them are targeted toward women who support pro-democracy groups and entities.
I've seen some of these posts from accounts on Facebook and Telegram showing clear public support for the military government. They include misogynistic, sexualized abuse, Photoshop pornography, as well as racist abuse that weaponizes any perceived support for the Muslim Rohingya minority.
I think there is a strategic aspect in the fact that they are trying to terrorize women from speaking out, and they're trying to silence women from speaking up their opinions, because they're trying to show that if you speak out on these, this is what we are going to do.
Meanwhile, Witness's research also found that just a handful of the Telegram channels were responsible for most of the abuse in their data set, and that the most common form of abuse was doxxing, meaning their information was publicly posted online without their consent. A quarter of these documented cases of doxxing came with an explicit call for the military authorities to take action against these women. We also found our own evidence of fresher, new doxxing campaigns. In one case, we spotted a photograph of a young woman at a wedding in rebel fatigues. We can't give away too much detail. It might endanger her. But this image was taken from social media and posted on one of the most influential pro-military Telegram channels, alongside her personal information. Within 24 hours of the post's upload, she was arrested, and we saw pro-military accounts celebrate her arrest and link it back to a particularly notorious Telegram channel. This still doesn't prove coordination between the military and troll accounts, but it's clear that what happens on these pages has real-world consequences. The Burmese military government denies any involvement in doxxing campaigns by such accounts on social media. With the help of BBC Burmese, we spoke to their Deputy Minister of Information, Zaw Min Thun.
There is no reason we would be linked to these accounts. When it comes to social networking sites, we monitor them as every government does. If we see something unusual, we will have to investigate.
One woman who was doxxed multiple times agreed to speak to me about her experience.
This is Tinsan Shonglei. I'm 31 years old and I'm a pro-democracy and human rights activist.
Shonglei, as she's often referred to, is a household name in Myanmar, famed for her activism by supporters and opponents in equal measure.
For activists like us, speaking true to power, I would say we always face the same thing all the time because we are like a generation that grew up with social media. So we use Facebook in our generations and we campaign, we mobilize our same age and generation through social media. So yeah, we face a lot of different struggle, especially online gender-based violence.
Targeted doxxing campaigns against Shonglei have in the past led her to adopt a second identity on social media, ensuring her personal and professional life are separate.
First, it was just my account they were sharing. We know what you're doing. And they share my screenshot and they were sharing around in their own account, different accounts. And then next time they include my family information, like where I lived, what's my ID number, what's my phone number, some personal information, including my sister's face and, you know, photos and, you know.
We flagged over 120 posts to Telegram that Myanmar witness had identified as targeted abuse and doxing. Immediately after, all but 18 of them were removed, and a number of the accounts appear to have been suspended. Telegram told us,
Telegram is a platform for free speech. However, sharing private information, doxing, and calling for violence are explicitly forbidden by our terms of service. Our moderators use a combination of proactive moderation and user reports to remove such content from our platform. This clear policy has allowed pro-democracy movements around the world to organize large-scale movements safely using our platform. For example, in Hong Kong, Belarus, and Iran.
Immediately after one of the most prominent channels was removed, a similar channel with a near-identical name emerged, with tens of thousands of followers. We've found a few more similarly named ones since then. Experts I speak to tell me they believe a well-oiled machine of people in support of the military runs these channels, and their backup channels too. Who they are is unknown to us. It's also impossible to know definitively where they come from. On Telegram, public channels, which are different to public groups, means those behind them can hide behind the channel name, with no private information advertised. Their identities are shrouded in secrecy. Burmese women in support of democracy aren't just targets for pro-military supporters. Myanmar Witnesses report found a small minority of these cases came from pro-democracy accounts too. Shonglei says she's experienced what she calls online gender-based violence from both sides.
The abuses or the blames or the attack come from not just from military. You know, the patriarchy is deeply embedded in our society. So that could come from anyone. Even in the revolutionary leader, a male leader could be sexist. So we are, as a woman revolutionary, we are fighting against different layers of oppressions, not just military dictatorship, but we are also fighting patriarchy in our house, in our community, in our social platforms.
Hanin, the activist I spoke to earlier, echoes this sentiment. She describes an online culture embedded in misogynistic practices. She says it's the driving force for the targeted abuse Burmese women face, regardless of their political leanings. Now she's tackling it head on using Facebook.
People know that you get criticized for expressing opinions, but what they don't know is that people have different opinions when they argue with a woman. So the album that I have on my Facebook profile is called When They Argue With a Woman. So they would make sexist comments. They would make comments about your appearance, what you wear, like how beautiful or ugly that you look. So I want to highlight that even though I might be saying the same thing as my other male activists might be saying, I got different comments as opposed to them having the normal arguments, you know, like arguing them about their opinions.
When we put the abuse raised by Myanmar Witness and the women we spoke to Facebook's parent company Meta, they said they had removed a large proportion of the content and that
women should feel safe no matter what space they're in. We don't allow gender-based hate speech, threats of sexual violence and exploitation or unwanted harassment on our apps. Our teams have built tools to help prevent women around the world from having to deal with online abuse in the first place. And we use technology and a team of Burmese speakers to take action on violating content in Myanmar. We've also hosted dedicated women's safety consultations on Myanmar to help inform our approach.
But Tom Andrews, the UN Special Rapporteur on the situation of human rights in Myanmar, doesn't think Facebook's actions are enough. Earlier this year, I reported for the BBC about the abuse Burmese women face. Tom Andrews responded to the report live on air and committed to taking our findings, along with Myanmar Witnesses, to the platforms.
So this is extremely dangerous. It's extremely disturbing to see this report. And of course, it is not surprising, given the nature of the junta and given the fact that the opposition, to a very large degree, is led by young people and by women. Because of this report, because of your report, we are going to draw this to their attention and discuss this with them. I've discussed these issues with social media companies. We've drawn the link between hate speech and violence and made it very clear to them that they have a fundamental responsibility.
Hanin, Ethan Zar and Shun Lei are three women forced to live in hiding. With prominence comes a higher risk of danger. When we raised the issue of women who had fled their homes for safety to Deputy Minister for Information Zorman Tun, he said that those who had must have committed a crime and that people who want to live in peace in Myanmar are living in peace. But how are women who reject military rule or even patriarchal norms to live in peace? We found that, particularly on Telegram, posts containing misogynistic sexualized abuse continues to flourish. Demeaning women, doxing women, and sometimes even damaging their reputation with Photoshop pornography. I asked these three women whether they're scared. They are. But their fear drives an undeniable need for change. Hanin will not let scare tactics deter her.
That's what they want me to do, right? They want me to stop talking about those things. So that's exactly what I will be doing. I will not stop and I will keep on talking about these things that they don't want to hear.
Ethan Zar wants to go all the way as a female politician with nothing holding her back.
If I turn around at this point, everything I've done will be for nothing. That's what keeps me going. I have come to endure criticism, attacks, and the suffering of life.
And for Shun Lei, activism is the very reason for her existence.
The junta can take my security, like they can take my home, they can drive me out, but they can't take away my identity. So that's my last defense and my protest against this.
That's it for this edition of BBC Trending's Trolled with me, Reha Kansara. A huge thanks to producers Nien Chan Ai and Sachin Croker editor Flora Carmichael, and Hal Haynes for mixing this program. If you want to get in touch about this report, then you can email me at reha.kansara, that's reha.kansara at bbc.co.uk. Or you can find me on Twitter. Trending is also on Facebook and Twitter. Just search for BBC Trending and follow us. And remember to leave us a rating or a review wherever you get your podcast from.